Well, thank you, everybody. We now have four very distinguished panelists, and I'm going to call on each of them individually, seriatim, and ask them to address some specific questions. The first one is Dianela P. Cedrés, who is the Deputy Permanent Representative of Uruguay here in Geneva, and also to other international organisations in Geneva. Previous to this post, she served as Deputy Director for Human Rights and Humanitarian Affairs in Montevideo. Dianela has also served as First Secretary to the Uruguayan Mission to the UN in New York City. Dianela, the question that I want to ask you is, what do you see as the main challenges at the UPR? For instance, what do you think of the topics covered and particularly the gaps remaining in SOGIESC recommendations?
Thank you.
10 minutes, please.
Sure. I want to thank you for inviting me to this event, and in fact I'm honored to represent my country in the launching of such interesting report. I remember a few years ago when we were launching the Yoga Carta principles also in New York within Mercosur countries, and now we are coming here almost there with a special mandate holder on the issue. It seems that we all, of course, has a lot of challenges ahead, but we reach also a lot and we advance a lot on the issue. It will be a pleasure to give you kind of a government perspective on the challenges and the main findings of the report, particularly based on the experience of Uruguay. And I will try to make some comments trying to respond to the question. But let me highlight first how important UPR was to us when we decided to go for the establishment of the specific mandate on sexual orientation and gender identity. We circulated in June a concept note, and there we highlighted, in fact, that 107 states from all regions have made voluntary commitment to address violence and discrimination based on sexual orientation and gender identity in the context of the UPR. And more than two-thirds of all states that received such recommendation accepted at least one, and often several such recommendations. And to us, was clearly an indication that a majority of states, in fact, welcomed constructive dialogue and had made an express commitment to address these human rights concerns. And this was a push for us to move the way forward, to think that the international community was prepared to go for the first step. As has been the case for other individuals who are targeted by violence and discrimination on different bases, we were and we are still convinced that the scale, seriousness and widespread nature of violence and discrimination against individuals based on their actual or perceived sexual orientation and gender identity require a specific response from the Human Rights Council in the form of a dedicated mechanism. And taking into account what you mentioned about what is happening in New York, I need to also send a message about that. The Human Rights Council needed to address this issue that it has done in the other cases on violence collected by UN, regional, as well as national human rights mechanisms. And the legal basis for this that was never questioned here in Geneva and now is questioned by some countries in New York is quite clear. Resolution 60/251 of the General Assembly decided that the Council shall be responsible for promoting universal respect for the protection of all human rights and fundamental freedoms for all, without distinction of any kind and in a fair and equal manner. The Council should address situations of violation of human rights. That's simple. This is the legal basis. And of course, the resolution 32/2 has as the legal basis the institutional building package. So in our understanding, when you question the legal basis, you are questioning the IB package and you are trying to reopen it. And it's something that we are highlighting, our colleagues are highlighting in New York. Of course, as the report states, the UPR is another mechanism together with a special, with the independent expert that can contribute to ensure change, to start a national process and open up new avenues for engaging governments on issues. And it's true that all of us have learned from it. I'm sure the findings and the recommendations of the report will be very useful for states and NGO representatives in order to advance the issues, but also to tackle the different challenges. Through them, we can understand what you need as civil society, what is useful to make changes on the ground, and at the same time, the civil society can understand what are the limits of the state, what are, how is the proceed of each government. We agree with the report that the UPR has been a crucial platform to make visible the wide array of human rights violations that LGBTI persons suffer. And I'm happy to read that the assessment of the NGOs are good in terms of how much the UPR has worked. I think that one of the challenges mentioned in the report is that many states under review are rarely reporting on implementation of LGBTI recommendations. But I want to mention that Resolution 16/21, one of the revision of the IB package, decided that from the second cycle, the emphasis should be given to follow up on implementation. So we think that the issue of the challenge on implementation and follow up is something that affects all recommendations in general, not only LGBTI ones. And we think that this is going to change if we really commit to what we decided a few years ago to highlight the issue of implementation now. The challenge related to follow-up and implementation is an issue very dear to my country, and as I said, it affects all. We had today a very interesting panel this morning on national mechanisms for follow-up, so we expect some improvements in this regard because we see how many countries are working on specific national mechanisms to follow-up on issues. In our understanding, as the Commission for Human Rights is still remembered to its role in the development of human rights law, we expect the Human Rights Council to be recognized for its contribution to implementation and follow-up, in fact, in future. It's true that perhaps there are many countries that still rarely report on SOGI issues, but this is expected also to change. We have already listened to many states during their presentation and their reviews to the UPR, providing explanation on the need to give time for social and cultural changes to take place in order for their governments to implement specific recommendations. And SOGI issues are among those that need this kind of structural changes to happen in order to ensure then changes on the ground. But there's also a need for education and capacity building, and this has come a lot from the NGO side to help us on that. When I started working on this issue posted in New York, I remember my first meeting with an NGO colleague, and I asked him to provide me on information because I needed to know exactly the difference between the L, the G, the V, the T, the I, the difference between them, the specificities, the particularities, the specific needs of each group, in order then to go with other colleagues and to try to explain them and to try to convince them about the need to go for something specific on the issue. I had also long conversations with different NGOs before presenting the resolution in June. And it was the same. I mean, we have to teach people about that. I had a lot of colleagues asking me that they didn't want the resolution because they didn't go to go far on gay rights. And I started to ask them, what was a gay right? Because my country was speaking about right to health, right to life, right to housing, right to privacy, freedom for assembly. These are gay rights? I mean, it's okay for me if they are also gay rights. I mean, we are talking about human rights. And this is the kind of explanation we have to provide to colleagues. And the same goes to specific issues that the report considers related to gender expression or sex characteristics. We have very deep conversations among the colleagues, the GRULA colleagues, when presenting the resolution, because we receive a lot of recommendations from NGOs trying us to include the reference to gender expression, for example, because it's something that we have in the Inter-American resolutions. But we thought that, I mean, we should start first consolidating the concepts that are already on the table, and then I mean, trying to explain and teach people about that, and then we can advance on the others. This is what we work in the region, and we have seen how much we have advanced in fact working from the very basic to and going beyond that. We need to continue putting the issue on the Human Rights Council agenda in every possible way. One of the recommendations of the report, in fact, is to address fear and ignorance, and I beg you to still continue pushing on that. I think it's a very good recommendation, in fact. The report highlights also the political nature of the UPR as one of the challenges, and the way that some states see to impose their own values on other countries. It happened to us in 2014. We wanted to accept all recommendations from the UPR as we did in the first cycle, and we couldn't because we received a specific recommendation that we couldn't accept because it went against our legislation. It was a discriminatory one because they asked us to respect marriage as an union between a man and a woman, and we cannot accept that. It's against our laws related to discrimination. So we understand that it's going to be happening, but we have to be pragmatic and realistic. The UPR is political because it's an intergovernmental process, and it's a mechanism of a political body. So we can't prevent others to use it politically. What we can do is using it in accordance with its purposes as a cooperative mechanism and ensuring that it is conducted in a non-selective, constructive, non-confrontational, and non-politicized manner. Lastly, I want to mention how important has been our engagement with civil society. We have been working with our national NGOs during the process of the drafting of the report and the midterm report to the UPR. But also we have been working a lot with NGOs with regard to the UPRs of other countries. We usually go to the UPR info sessions before every session. And we receive a lot of material. We have a lot of meetings with NGOs. The problem is that in our case, and I understand that for every country is different, the recommendations are prepared in capital. It's not us. So we send all the information. We can send the recommendations. We can know, I mean, in a way, the sensitivities and the needs you have for the recommendations, but then it's capital. So one of my recommendations in terms of the way you can approach that is to try to see how is the process in different countries and to try to work basically and particularly on those that are preparing the recommendations so they can directly hear from you and then use what you tell in terms of the formulation of the recommendations, in terms of what you exactly need from us. It's better if you do it directly with the people that has to draft the recommendation at the end of the day. Thank you.
Dianela, thank you very much. It was very interesting, the diplomatic political aspect and the need for clarity when norms are challenged and follow-up is attempted. I was also really interested to hear you talk about the incredulity about gay rights as opposed to human rights, because it reminded me of the early days of corporate social responsibility when people were also incredulous that human rights would actually apply to corporations and what corporations do, and yet now it's pretty much part of the mainstream. So that was very interesting. Thank you. I will now give the floor to Nada Chaiyajit, who is the LGBTI representative from the Thai CSO Coalition for the UPR. Nada is an intersex and transgender advocate from Thailand, and she has worked as a transgender advocate since 2006. Her work has included LGBTI rights, sexual health, and media advocacy, both national and international. She's told me that she's just graduated from law school and is willing to pursue her dream as a professional human rights lawyer. So well done, and it never hurts to advertise. Good for you. Nada, the question that I want to pose to you is, would you share with us your findings of this report and the ones that you see as most important, particularly in your context in Thailand and your experience with the UPR, looking in particular as you do at civil society, could you share with us the process of coalition building that occurred in Thailand and the way in which LGBTI and Sojiesk issues managed to become part of the Thai coalition and engagement with UPR?
Good afternoon. First, I would like to acknowledge all the work that ILGA and the International and IBAHRI Association Human Rights Institute and our international put in this research and also invite me to be here. After I went through the report, and I would like to speaking on behalf of the human rights defenders, it would be more easier for me to share the experience. What I found, the first thing is, at the introduction part, it is great to see the explanation of the UPR with the intrication of the Yogyakarta principles, because in Thailand, back to 2008, that there are some key players, NGO and CSO in Thailand, translated the Yogyakarta principle in Thailand into Thai language, that wished to pursue the government to implement the Yogyakarta principle to reform the domestic law and even legislate the new law to uphold the human rights situation in relation to Sojiesk issues, which I found very simple. And if we can really show how that our UPR and the Yogyakarta could work together. And also, I found the Annex 1 to provide the list of calls to actions made the following with the Yogyakarta principle. As an human rights defender, I could say that CSO, when we conduct a strategy and action plan, it's really hard to capture what's the puzzle we should put in the legal framework and dealing with the sovereignty's power when the government take the leading in terms of the policy implementations and legal legislation. So this is very helpful. And also, I still find that it's also outlined the smart follow-up and implementation mechanisms, which is really give us a tool to dealing with the government. And also, one of the particular barrier is, in Thailand, even we are very well known as the country that open for LGBTI people to live our life freely, but the discrimination is invisible, that it's hardly to be seen in general. So I could say that the CTA shows us how we could really drawing the work and also the table of the CTA is really what the government needs, because even our Thai state show that they are try hard to improve the situations, but the limitation numbers of legal and policy makers and legal practitioners in the level who understand the Sojiesk issue well, and together with the barrier on the legal issue, the domestic law is still together become a huge barrier that the government is hard to take into account to implement on their recommendations. So the table will be really helpful for the government. And the research also give us the implementation overview and remind us that Sojiesk recommendation made to the state under review have never been the ultimate goal for the UPR, but the implementations and those recommendations that when we go back to our countries, that will shape the new law and policies and practice that will actually improve the situation of LGBTI in Thailand. And also, what I like the most is about this part of the, this part also bring the voice of human rights defenders who joined the UPR pre-session advocacy weeks, that usually in our daily life is impossible for us to sharing information, but the collections of the quotes of the useful techniques and voices could be a part of our action plan and strategy plan in terms of working collaboratively with the government and also strengthening the members of Thai CSO in general. What I would like to address next is about how we build the coalitions. Usually, LGBTI movements is separate from the general other human rights issues because we never been counted as the important human rights issues because Thailand always pay attention on civil and political rights, which is take a major role. But what I could say, when dealing with the democratic government, or even right now, the situation in Thailand, we are under the military, military government also, what we found that social rights never been recognized. Because when they approach to us, they keep saying that the most important that we have to improve the situation to the population in general, make sure that the quality of life is better and better day by day. But lacking of understanding on social rights issues, it's hard to clarify for them that no matter what, how good policy, both democratic government and special government take action to improve it. But for example, like you may raise the minimum wage of the labor's payment, but if we still received discriminations against us, we couldn't get a good job, we couldn't, you know, be a part of being promoted to work in the high level, no matter what, how good the policies on labor rights you propose to the people in general, we are far behind to get it. So when we start the, so that's why at the first cycle, the social SC issue was dropped. I don't even know why, but I think because when the first cycle UPR is still new for Thai CSO as well. So when we learn from the past, this time we planned together with the UPR Info Asia, which I would like to thank you a lot for them, that it's happened accidentally at the reception at the US Embassy in Bangkok to celebrate Pride Month. And it becomes a huge change among LGBTI movement is ourselves, because we received an opportunity to conduct the first ever joint submission on LGBTI's UPR report, and together with the support of the ILGA, so finally we can make it possible. And the successful is not about the first step of the successful story is not about we received the recommendation, but it's about that the first time that OSHA report include our human rights issues, at least five issues. For example, like the constitutional to uphold the social rights in general, family-like estrangement to include LGBTI, and also latent recognition for transgender people, which is very great to moving forward. And we also received the, after we submit the joint submission, and the UPR Info Asia play a crucial role to gathering a group of the human rights defenders, in total about 23 issues, and set up the coalitions. First, we thought that how we could be a part of that. And what we found that it's really good to, they set up like a workshop that bring everyone in, and starting to share experiences and find the interconnection between issues. For example, in women's rights, of course, many of the lesbian and bisexual women take the leading role in the women's rights movement. We also found that in the student rights, LGBTI students still face bully in the school. And we also find that the indigenous group of people, there are some part of the LGBT members in there. Why should we just start to make intersectionalities through strengthening the coalition power in terms of negotiating and exercise our rights with the government? UPR Info Asia also provide us our technical support in terms of developing the advocacy tool, which is very cool for me. It's the first time ever we have the fact sheets to present. And I think this is why we receive the recommendations straight there, like on this, from the Mexico and from the South Africa that mentioned about, from the Mexico that mentioned the first time ever about like sexual orientation, even it's together with their women's rights. And the South Africa's provides recommendations directly state on the effectiveness on gender equality bills, which is inside the bills, is the first time the Thailand recommendation about the Thai state legislate about the anti-discrimination bill that includes transgender people. So right now it's just this.
That's it? Okay, good. Good timing. Nada, thank you. That was not only informative and interesting, but very valuable discussion about the importance of coalition building in all of this. I now give the floor to Henry Coe. Henry is a legal and human rights specialist with the NGO Fortify Rights in Malaysia. And he's also a secretariat member of PROHAM, the Society for the Promotion of Human Rights. Prior to joining Fortify Rights, he worked as a legal consultant with UNAIDS Asia Pacific in a leading pioneer legal training project targeted at lawyers working on transgender rights through strategic litigation. Very interesting. And Henry, therefore, the question that I've got for you is that it seems that the majority of UPR recommendations have been on law reform. For example, criminalisation of violence against LGBTI persons or discrimination, or rather decriminalisation of consensual same-sex relationships. What do you see as the main challenge in advancing law reform on SOGIESC issues in Malaysia, and could you please share with us the rationale and the results of the initiative to train lawyers in these areas in Malaysia? Okay.
Thank you, Phillip, for the question. First of all, I would like to congratulate Helen, Diana, and Dodo on this brilliant report on SOGI, and thank you for having me here once again. Well, before I actually come to the part on how useful would this, what are the main challenges that it will be when we are using strategic litigation to address on the issue of advancing LGBTI rights in Malaysia or even the ASEAN region, I'd like to share a little bit on the Pioneer project that Phillip has mentioned that we worked on a few months ago. So as an overall assessment, we had this legal training project in Malaysia 6 months ago, organized by UNAIDS Asia Pacific and under the initiative of the Being LGBTI project of UNDP. In a general note, it was noted that the majority of participants who joined us, who are actually lawyers themselves, gave good feedback, and most of them would like to engage in similar initiatives further on. It is important to note that in this training itself, it was the first time ever that Malaysia actually has a legal training to engage with different stakeholders of legal activists, lawyers, the legal aid centers throughout the country, as well as the Malaysia Bar Council, to talk and touch on the issue on transgender legal activism, on how can we actually use strategic litigation to advance the rights of trans people and arrest cases throughout Malaysia. Well, just to give you a rough assessment, from January to September this year, 2016, there have been at least 70 cases of transgender arrests in Malaysia throughout the country. So as a result of this training, what we realized from the feedback of the participants is that they now have a better understanding on the historical and fundamental development of the trans community in Malaysia, and also as to why the legal rights of trans people continue to deteriorate in the country, followed by the rising cases of arbitrary arrests amongst the trans community. One interesting thing that was actually highlighted in our final report of this project is that among all the lawyers who attended the workshop, we realized that not many Sharia lawyers are involved in this project. And although we did invite them to actually to come and join us, to come and have a dialogue with us on trans issues across Malaysia, on the arrest cases, on the intersectionality between the Federal Constitution of Malaysia, the Penal Code, as well as the Sharia law. So in Malaysia, for example, as a Muslim country, we have come a long way on the development of Sharia law just around like 3 to 4 decades ago, on how the Sharia enactment started out as just fatwas for as a regulation to advise on family law matters for Muslim families, but now it has really been strongly assimilated into the main legislation of Malaysia. And more recently, just a month ago, we are going to have a new law to be amended to incorporate Sharia law into the federal laws in Malaysia. And we do see this as a big challenge when it comes to advancing rights of LGBTI persons in the country. Okay. And certainly the legal training itself for lawyers do provide cognizance for all the stakeholders and participants, including CSOs who are working on LGBTI rights in Malaysia, to expand their networks for future collaboration among matters relating to trans rights, advocacy and legal protection in Malaysia. One thing that I would personally like to highlight as a lawyer myself is that when an arrest happens in a country like Malaysia, we do realize that it is more beneficial for a lawyer to actually come into play, or a legal person, to assist the person who is being remanded by the police in jail whenever there's an arrest that's happening in a country like ours, than to have people from the CSO to come to assist them when that actually happened. But that doesn't mean that you know, we are disregarding altogether the good work that has been carried out by the CSOs in Malaysia. But what I'm trying to focus and highlight over here is that when a person gets remanded in Malaysia and gets kept in the jail, many times, and there are a lot of cases whereby the abuses, sexual violence that is carried out upon these people, especially on trans people, in jail by both the authorities and the inmates itself. So I think the main goal and over here is to try to get them out of jail as soon as possible. And we do see that by means of having lawyers to bail them out, or to actually even represent them at the first trial as soon as possible, that would actually be a good step for them to be rescued in that regard. And we also did talk about having a judicial cause symposium that might take place in 2017. The very reason why we actually had this idea among with the former Special Rapporteur of Rights to Health, Anand Grover, is the fact that we do see that if we we are able to bring together judges or lawmakers around the region to come together to discuss on what are the main issues, what are the main challenges that we face, and what are the possible steps of law reforms that we can bring across the region to help in advancing rights of the LGBTI persons in that sense. In terms of the challenges that we are facing, All right. So we realized that it is also very important for us to incorporate more Sharia lawyers, as I was mentioning earlier, in future participations of a training or workshop like as such, to encourage a more realistic and viable approach in tackling these issues in a country like Malaysia, where you actually have two sets of legal system. We have our Malaysian Federal Constitution, our main legislation, and then you have the intersectionality between the Sharia courts and the federal courts in that sense. And we also hope to focus and combine more SOGI issues and educational awareness in future workshops in that sense. And the legal aid centers in Malaysia also opined that a follow-up session should occur to measure the progress of the legal protection as a way forward, that we do not want this pioneer project to just stop over here. And it is also worth noting that during the training itself, we carried out a judicial comparison between countries such as India, Nepal, Bangladesh, and Malaysia, based on a comprehensive legal compendium study. The main similarity that we find between these countries in Malaysia is the fact that cases related to trans people do not intersect with Section 377 of the Penal Code. And this is because mainly that touches more on gay people, in that sense, under the Commonwealth law. And this separates the whole distinct judicial discussion between homosexuality and trans issues, although transgender is part of the LGBTI framework. And this explains very well why the situation in certain countries such as India is advancing, for example, with the recently enacted Transgender Protection Bill that was came into law since July this year, which actually stems from a good example of a successful strategic litigation, namely in the case of NELSA against the Union of India. One last point before I end. So throughout the legal training, we also set up a transgender defenders coalition to actually give, to collaborate between CSOs as well as lawyers and the Malaysian Bar Council to have a monitoring system to document all the arrest cases or upcoming arrest cases that we receive firsthand, as well as to actually afford those trans people who are being arrested that these lawyers can immediately bail them out wherever they are in the 14 states of Malaysia. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Henry. That was, excuse me, that was an excellent description of the difficulties in working in a Muslim country with Sharia, excuse me, and also the strategic litigation aspect of developing this. Strategic litigation is much more difficult than it sounds, I think, because the emphasis should be on the strategic rather than just it being litigation. So thank you very much indeed. I finally give the floor to Michael van Gelderen. Michael is a human rights officer at the OHCHR, and he is working on human rights, gender identity, sex characteristics, and sexual orientation, with a focus on supporting state implementation of international human rights law standards and norms. He's also supporting engagement of all stakeholders, including civil society organisations, with the UN mechanisms, and also on collaboration within the UN system and with regional human rights mechanisms, and as well as developing tools and training materials on the subject. So you have an enormous mandate, Michael. I know you've read the report. What struck you most about the findings in the report, and what do you see as the main challenges now that we're preparing for the third cycle of UPR? As a couple of the presenters today have said, it's only a small number of recommendations have a specific or even a general legal basis to them. Very few of them mention the Yogyakarta principles and so on. Do you think that recommendations could be strengthened by a clearer reference to these norms? But as other President, as I've said today. Interestingly, there has at the same time been a steady increase in the number of SOGIESC-based recommendations in UPR. What do you think contributed to this important development? How can we go even further, and how do you explain this apparent dichotomy?
Thank you, Phillip. And now, first of all, congratulations to ILGA, to ARC International, and to the International Bar Association. I've gone through the report. It's very rich in analysis and detail. I think it's really an essential tool for anyone that's thinking of already engaging in the UPR on these issues, whether it's states or civil society, or indeed UN organizations. I think the report, some of the main findings that I take away, in part, is the success story that is engagement on these issues in the context of the UPR. As Dianela mentioned, the UPR is a political mechanism. It's engagement between states as peers on the human rights situation in their respective countries. And the fact that sexual orientation and gender identity issues and the rights of LGBT persons, and recently we've seen intersex persons as well, in that sphere shows that these issues are part of the international discussion on human rights. It shows that the developments in the expert bodies and the mechanisms that we've seen in the last 20 years, the treaty bodies and the special procedures, have firmly landed in the political space. That's a reflection of the resolutions of the Council, the engagements of states, and I think that's very much here to stay. I think it shows the importance of this pillar of the human rights mechanism, that you have the supervisory bodies that look at how states implement their legal obligations, and you have the thematic experts that are the special procedures mandate holders, including the newly appointed independent expert, and you have this peer mechanism between states. And I think all of these three parts of the UN human rights systems are really complementary, and especially for states in the case of the UPR that haven't necessarily ratified that many treaties or that haven't necessarily engaged with that many special procedures experts. So I think there's a lot of added value to the UPR, and I think on this issue particularly, and I think that comes out in the report. I very much enjoyed reading the section on impacts and reading how the different stakeholders, including states and civil society, reflected on those. Whether it's specific legal or policy changes at the national level, where stakeholders felt that engagement at the UPR had impacted positively. Now, with any of these changes, it's very hard to attribute exactly, or this was because of the UPR, or that was because of the UPR, but it's clear that many stakeholders feel that engagement at the UPR has contributed to these changes. And I think that's tremendously positive. And that alone, for me, is really enough to take these findings and this report very seriously and try to see, well, how can we build on those positive outcomes of the first two cycles? How can we go further? But the report goes further, and it highlights how civil society organizations at the national level have been empowered and have built their capacity through this process, their technical capacity and their political and advocacy capacity to engage with their states and engage with other stakeholders at the regional and the international level. I think, you know, we heard from Nada how the UPR process has also enabled stronger coalitions between national organizations and international organizations, civil society, but also between, for example, trans organizations and more generalist human rights or generalist LGBT organizations, and also between civil society and states, and there's some examples in the report. And that can happen publicly. You can have public engagement, but I think the stories that are also interesting is, well, we submitted this shadow report, and then the government was calling us up, and they wanted to talk to us. And that might happen behind closed doors. That might be a private dialogue. But I think for political change at the national level, those conversations are also incredibly important. Dialogue is the essence of the UPR, and the fact that it's having that impact at national level, I think, is extremely encouraging. And then finally, the report highlights how the UPR engagement on this process can also lead to increasing public awareness. So it goes into the newspapers. You have public debates. You might have public discussions on TV. Or within government, people are asking questions. So I think this awareness-raising function is also very valuable from the UPR. And I think that reflects more broadly outside of this issue also the value of the UPR as a process of dialogue, as a process of raising awareness on this. I think Dianela really nailed it when you mentioned, you know, out of all of the states that have received recommendations on this issue, it's 165 according to the report, you have 108 that accepted at least one recommendation. So that's two-thirds of states. And we're always hearing about polarization, and I will get to that in a minute. But I think if we step back, we have two-thirds of any states that's received a recommendation on this on these issues that have accepted at least one recommendation. And it's the majority of all UN member states. So I think we need to put into perspective the talk about polarization and recognize the very positive outcome of discussions on this issue at the UPR that shows a majority of UN, an absolute majority of UN states are engaged. The vast majority of states that have been received recommendations have been positive about at least some of them. Now, in terms of the challenges, I think the report does a really good job, and congratulations to the authors, of highlighting where things could be better. And I think that's from gaps between what the international human rights law is saying about these issues and what the expert mechanisms are saying about these issues and where we're seeing the conversation at the UPR level. And perhaps the conversation in the UPR has been focusing on certain specific issues, more general discrimination discussions, also more general discussions around violence, a bit about decriminalization. But there's this whole diversity of issues that have been raised by UN mechanisms that's not necessarily reflected. And I think the report asks rightly, how can we improve that? How can we work with the different stakeholders, whether it's civil society, whether it's states, to raise awareness of this? Stakeholders might not be aware, and to give them tools to improve that. And that includes specific issues. So we've seen how on the rights of trans people, on the rights of intersex people, that has featured much less in the UPR. And OECHR has done a survey of what states are actually doing in general, what policies and laws states are adopting on this. And we're also seeing gaps on the very same issues in state practice. So it's not just in the context of the UPR that you have these gaps. I think these gaps are reflective more generally of where states are at in their engagement on these issues. And so I think that's an important finding, and one that we as an office would certainly recommend greater attention to. I think, you know, you've pointed out implementation. And I think, you know, different panelists have also said, this is a general, this has been a discussion in the context of the UPR. No, it was a new mechanism. We've now gone through two cycles, and I think most stakeholders are agreed that we need to move towards better mechanisms for following up on recommendations, for supporting states and other stakeholders to implement their commitments and all recommendations that they receive, and in general their obligations. So I think it's very important to focus on, in this context as well, and seeing how in that discussion about, well, how do we set up the monitoring mechanisms, how do we set up the technical advisory and support mechanisms to support states to implement their obligations, and make sure that these also include attention to the rights of LGBT and intersex people. The question on polarization, I think, you know, Dianela answered it, and I think I alluded to it as well. I think, you know, the issue is not that states have different opinions. That's the whole purpose of the Human Rights Council, is dialogue between states that come with different political traditions and cultural contexts and views to dialogue constructively around these issues. I think the question that the report raises, how do we ensure that the dialogue that's happening within the UPR is firmly anchored to international human rights law standards? And there, perhaps, as the report concludes, and I agree, I think we can do better. And perhaps part of that is maybe laying it out more clearly what these standards are for states. Human rights mechanisms in the last 20 years have have developed an incredible amount of jurisprudence. And certainly we have the Yogyakarta Charter principles, and I think they're very important in the international framework. But we also have this huge body of work that's been carried out by the treaty bodies and others in the last 20 years. And these have been consolidated, so they're not just existing in this dispersed fashion. But, you know, the office has in its two reports to the Human Rights Council, the High Commissioner's reports, have consolidated that jurisprudence. We've published booklets explaining all of the different standards. And perhaps, you know, we can do certainly better to disseminate these and have that dialogue with states so that when perhaps the dialogue or the conversation of the UPR veers away from where international human rights law is at, how can we have that dialogue to keep the framing within international human rights law? For me, in terms of the next steps and some questions I have to the authors and to the audience, and I include myself, is how can the report raises some questions. You know, why do states do this? Why do states not do that? And I'd be interested in hearing whether there's further research and further conversations and interviews that will happen with state representatives based on the findings of this report to try to find, well, how can we provide tools to act on the recommendations of the report's findings? How can we popularize the contents of this report with civil society, with state representatives? How can we strategize about giving greater visibility and attention to the rights of trans people and intersex people within a UPR and more broadly within the human rights conversation? I think I'll stay there. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Michael. Speaking as someone from an NGO, it was really interesting hearing the view from the UN. We now have 15 minutes or so, which I'm going to throw open to questions, comments from the audience. In that regard, if our three co-authors would like to come up and join us on stage, that would be great. If you wouldn't mind. when you're asking a question, would you please indicate who you are and your affiliation, if any, and if there's any particular member of the panel to whom you would like to address your question or make your comment. So thank you. So are there, Michael's already posed one, but are there any questions from the audience? Yes, please.
Thank you. Lee McCumber from the Canadian Mission. Not a question, but rather a comment, and given the time, we'll keep it brief. Just wanted to send a sincere appreciation to the authors of this report. Canada, who's been a strong supporter of LGBTI rights, as well as the UPR, it's no surprise that this has been one of our priorities for our UPR recommendations. And we have a lot of work to do, thanks to this report, of going back and thinking how we can be smarter and better and more strategic and more specific for the third cycle. So this will be very valuable for us. And the other thing that we continue to work on is about the implementation question. So not only how to be smarter of how we're recommending, but how our missions on the ground abroad can work closer with civil society to actually assist countries in implementing the recommendations we've made. So these are sort of two areas that we'll continue to work on and areas for improvement, but this report will very much be helpful for us in that regard. Thank
good.
You.
Thank you. It's very good to know. There any other, yes, question here?
Thank you. I'm Brian from the Permanent Mission of Israel. I also want to join to thank the report. I still don't have a copy, so I hope to get one soon that we can check. But for what I heard, it was really useful. And I talked a little before with Diana, and we are going to keep talking on that. But Israel has been working very hard on trying to insert these kind of recommendations. And some of the things I think that we haven't done it even by intuition. And now I can see that there is a path or things that we can follow or more things to develop. We included actually reference to intersex surgery to Ireland a month ago. So it's great to see that those is a topic that we should focus on. So it's good to know that we may be on the right path, and I hope to be more able to interact and continue on that way. Thank you.
Excellent, that's great. Any other questions?
Yes, up the back, please.
Yeah, this is Arvind from ARC. Again, congratulations on a really fantastic report. But I'd just like to maybe point to one aspect of the strategic litigation question and how it could possibly link to the UPR. That might also be linked to the question of implementation more generally, where the important thing of the UPR is, in a sense, you have your state, your own country, making a public statement on what the position vis-a-vis LGBTI rights is. And it can have all kinds of consequences. I'll give you an example from the Indian context. The fact that Sweden asked a question to the Indian government on, does Section 377 of the anti-sodomy law criminalize homosexuality? The government answered, the government representative answered, saying it doesn't. And that was used in the Delhi High Court, where the judge basically said the government is bound by what he called a notion of promissory estoppel. You promised not that the law doesn't bind, therefore you will not use the law, therefore we can decriminalize. Executive estoppel was the notion he used. So I think to focus the question a little bit, I mean, maybe to the panelists in general, on the implementation question, can you think of ways in which we can take this forward? One key aspect is we have to build a strong relationship between the national and the regional and the international. That's obviously very key to the entire process. But I'd welcome any thoughts from any of the panelists on how we can take the implementation question further.
Thank you. Would anybody like to respond to that? Henry?
Thank you for the question, Ravind. I think in that regard, first of all, what we can actually see from the whole UPR process itself, as well as from the report, is that for the very first time, the states under review, they are actually being asked or broader questions that touch on LGBTI issues. And for the very first time as well, issues such as LGBTI issues that states do not address them prior to this, now more so that they are actually being talked about in that regard. And that is why we have the idea of the judicial symposium that is coming on. We are hoping to use both a national and a regional mechanism in that sense to then, based on what has been studied or what have we found from the UPR analysis itself, and how can we then use case studies as well as legal reforms to change the situation for LGBTI persons across the region, for example. And for me, specifically, of course, I'm speaking for the ASEAN region. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Michael, you said you'd like to respond. Yeah.
Thanks, Arvind. I think part of the discussion around implementation also has to do with moving from the what to the how. That's one of the questions also asked in the report. And what are states actually doing? What are the positive practices of states? And I refer to this OECHR research. Actually, we're about to publish this document. I only have one copy, but It's basically a survey of around 200 examples of what states are actually doing. And the idea of the positive practices that we're seeing is it's not just abstract recommendations. It's really looking, it's not about what states are doing on the other side of the world. States in every region are taking steps, whether it's government policies or courts or national human rights institutions are taking active steps to protect the rights of LGBT and intersex people. And so for us at the office, part of the answer to the implementation question is we need to collect more examples and give feedback to states about what is the positive that's already happening to inspire change in other countries and focus on those positive narratives of change as well. And also, you know, UPR is a peer mechanism, and so looking at the positive practice of peers, maybe from their own region, maybe neighboring countries, I think is also a positive way to try to approach it.
Thank you. Nada?
So I would like to address that I think UPR should be like a democratic process and inclusive ones. So from my point of view, that it's time to expanding the definitions, especially on the civil and political rights, but far beyond the right to vote, for example, in Thailand. So, but must be a participation of all civil society. And to be specific, as you wish to have a specific recommendation, you must be on ground as much as you can. But one of the majority barriers is so almost like international or intergovernmental agency or embassies usually like providing the funding or any kind of technical support to the international NGO or the big organizations or CSO instead of direct funding to the and technical support to the local organizations. So perhaps it's time to create a inclusive platform to support the local communities. It doesn't mean that's only about direct funding, but also any kind of technical support, which is the most required by the CSO on the ground.
Thank you. Diana.
Well, I would very like first to comment, I think, about Canada, that I think I forgot in part of my presentation. Actually, Canada is the top recommending state. So we have, for example, in the very first case, Czech Republic is a recommending state who has recommended more recommendations, sorry for the repetition, during the first cycle, but we'll have Argentina during the second cycle. But among all the recommendations, Canada has been the one who has put 97 SOGIAS recommendations. And then we have, for example, the case of Israel, who has consistently mentioned not LGBTI or not SOGIAS, just holding it back or as an umbrella recommendation, but has consistently been mentioning gender identity and expression issues and intersex issues. So I think we need more states like Canada, more states like Uruguay, like Israel, and more states like the ones that have been participating in all this process. Second, Michael, you make a question about how are we going or how are we planning to share these recommendations of the report with some states. Actually, once we had the findings of the report and the recommendations of the report, here ARC International, the International Bar Association, and ILGA managed to have a meeting with a group of four or five states, and we shared with them the findings. And it was a very, very interesting conversation. And it was more of a one-on-one meeting with them. They asking us, so what is that? What do you need? What is why do you do this or why do you think that? And I think that was like a very, very constructive part of our research, and I hope that hopefully we, the three of us that are here in Geneva, can continue having those type of meetings with a little amount of states so we can actually make more public the recommendations of this report. I forgot. Ah, no, good. The last part. So I remember that I, in part of the research, we interview an officer of the Office of the Human Rights, of the High Commissioner Office of Human Rights, and this person always was pointing the UPR is an entry point for SOGIAS issues, and what we need is actually states sharing good practices with other states, because sometimes when it comes to implementation, you don't know actually how to implement. One, because first, those recommendations are very ample, so that has been actually one of the problems, to have those broader the recommendations. You don't actually know, first, as civil society, how to follow up them, but then as a state, you don't know actually how to implement them. And then the second one is, you have this amount of recommendations, but then you don't know how to do it, or who has done it. And I think like sharing good practice is a very, very good and positive thing. And finally, we, the research team, made a survey with civil society. And our survey has a result of an amazingly 89% of respondents who have said, we actually have engaged in a follow-up mechanism and implementation with our own government. So I think, of course, we need to work. And I think that is one of the most key challenges for the third cycle is work, working implementation and follow-up. But I think we are in a good path.
Good. Thank you. Dodo.
Yeah, thank you. I wanted to get back to Michael's question about what can we do about the underrepresentation of trans and intersex specific recommendations. And I think at least two sides to that coin, but the two that I want to mention, one is what can civil society do, and the other one is what can states do. And I think it's important to highlight that trans groups are very and intersex groups are very often completely marginalized within larger LGBTI communities on the ground. So, you know, the question of is this work going on at the country level by trans and intersex activists? That's an important question to ask. Like, who gets to do this work? And who gets to come to Geneva to influence missions? And I think in this aspect, funders have a really crucial role, and also international LGBTI NGOs that actually have the resources to support activists coming in or doing research on the ground or doing follow-up. I think that's one thing. The other thing, what can states do? I think one is that they need to listen better, and they need to listen to civil society when it's voicing a huge array of human rights violations. Because it's not enough to make recommendations about discrimination and criminalization, because it's not going to help everyone. More specifically, it's not going to help trans and intersex people against whom coerced surgeries are taking place, for instance. It's just not going to be specific or helpful enough. So listening to civil society and listening specifically to trans and intersex groups and activists is crucial. And the second part is that states are in some way and not in a very difficult position, and I think here OHHR's dissemination work is really, really crucial, because there are standards within the UN that are really positive already. For instance, the Special Rapporteur on Torture years ago set the standard that coerced surgeries against intersex children is a violation under his mandate. And the same goes for forced sterilization of trans people when that is a requirement of legal gender recognition. So the standards are there. And I agree with everyone who mentioned this before in the panel that the UPR has a huge potential to reaffirm these existing standards. And I really hope that we're going to see more of that in the next cycle.
Thank you. Well, unless there are any other comments, no. Yeah, very briefly.
Yeah, thanks. Just in response to Arvind and maybe from the standpoint of the International Bar Association's Human Rights Institute, I think the question behind the report for us was how to support the legal profession in being more involved in the UPR, but also in advancing the rights of LGBTI persons in general. And I think that has been a learning process for us to hear hear the different example of strategic litigations, how much we have to learn from one country to another, what's happening from the legal tradition. Like if you are in Commonwealth countries, if you are in Sharia law countries, and hearing the same, like if you have case law from neighbor countries, it will have an impact on your case law. And if you receive a recommendation from a neighbor country at the UPR, it will have more impact than a recommendation from other countries. So there's interconnection between countries which look at each other in terms of case law and look at each other in terms of recommendations. And there is a dynamic behind, and there is a dynamic where you understand and why UPR recommendations can't or can be implemented on the ground. So we do believe that there could be a segment that can play a greater role, and we wish we can have this example of regional symposium, which can feed also the reflection, the recommendations at the UPR. So I think that's a lesson learned for us. There are recommendations to lawyers and legal professions. It's for us to actually move forward. So I think it was a first step for us to understand how to move ahead.
Thank you, Helene. Now, we're now at the end of our time, so I'd like to thank all of you in the audience for coming along and participating. As we all know, sometimes you come to sessions like this or side events, and occasionally there are more people on the stage than there are in the audience. So I'm really pleased to see all of you here today. I understand the copies of the reports have run out, but you should be able to find them online on the website of each of the organisations that have contributed to it. Finally, I must thank the co-authors and all of the panellists today. We've had a wonderful discussion of not just a descriptive analysis of what's happening in the UPR recommendations in this area, but a consideration of impact, domestic implementation, the development of treaty norms, the development of customary international law, comparative approaches, the importance of building coalitions, looking at other legal systems such as Sharia,
the valuable and important area of strategic litigation and issues from within the UN processes themselves. So would you please join with me in thanking all of our expert contributors this afternoon.